we have the parable of the Good Samaritan. And Jesus tells this parable, this story, and I think for most of us it is very familiar. And so what I want to do to start today is to tell the parable of the Good Samaritan in maybe just a little different way. And I'm going to need your help. I'm going to need some volunteers to help me. So we're going to get started, and when you want to volunteer, you just raise your hand. But it goes like this. Once upon a time, there was a Minnesota Viking fan, okay? Who wants to volunteer to be a Minnesota Viking fan? Raise your hand. Come on, I need somebody. Right here, Mary, come on up. Awesome, okay? Let's give a round of applause to our Minnesota Viking fan. She didn't know this, but she's going to put on an Adrian Peterson jersey, okay? All right. Awesome, and you don't have to put the hat on, Mary, unless you want to. I have socks, too. You don't need to put the socks on either, but I want to tell you that I only wear these socks on game day, but I do wear them on game day, so there's our Minnesota Viking fan. Come on up here, because we're going to act this out, okay? Right here, there's the camera, in case you want to know, right there, okay? All right, good. And a Minnesota Viking fan was walking in downtown Minneapolis. Awesome. And right after a game, and she was excited, of course, because the Vikings won, which must have been early in the season, not late in the season, right? They won, so she was walking, and she was really happy, and she had her wallet in her pocket. She had an expensive watch on her wrist, and all of a sudden, there were two or three robbers. Who wants to be two or three robbers? Raise your hand. Can be kids too. Okay, back here. We got one back here. Where else? Somebody else, come on up. We need at least two. One over here. Come on up. Come on up. Whoever wants to come up and be a robber, come on up, okay? So some robbers came up to this Minnesota Viking fan, unsuspecting, and don't really have to do this in church, but they beat her up. Okay, pretend you're going to beat her up. She went to the floor, to the ground, and she was moaning and groaning. And they, and the robbers are high-fiving each other. And they stole her hat, because it was such a great hat, and they took her wallet. And they took her watch, and they took her valuables, and they left her. Nope, she really has a watch on. Isn't that awesome? They took her valuables, and they left her lying in the ditch, half dead. Okay? Big hand for our robbers. I don't know if we've ever done that before in church. Okay? Thank you. When all of a sudden there came a Lutheran pastor walking by. Who wants to be a Lutheran pastor? Right here, our acolyte. Awesome. Perfect. Okay. Here comes our Lutheran pastor, and he's got an annual meeting coming up, so he's very, very busy, and he sees this person and hears her moaning and groaning louder. And he knows that he should probably stop and help, but what does he do? He walks by on the other side of the road. Okay, thank you. A round of applause to our Lutheran pastor. And then came one or two church members. Who wants to be a church member? Or two? I need your help. Come on up. Church member or two. All right, awesome. Here comes a church member. Here comes another church member. Good job. You can come up too. We can have three. There were three church members, and they were headed to a small group prayer meeting. And it was a very important prayer meeting. They were going to pray for all kinds of things, including people in need. But they were walking by. They saw this woman in need. She was moaning and groaning. And they knew that they should stop and help, but they had to get to their prayer meeting because they were leading it, and so they walked by on the other side of the road. kind of kicked her as they walked by. Okay? Thank you. Round of applause to our church members. All right. And then came a Green Bay Packer fan. And as you know, there are some deep-seated prejudice between Minnesota Viking fans and Green Bay Packer fans. They don't always like each other. So I need a Green Bay Packer fan right here. Awesome. All right. Thank you. You get to put on this Green Bay Packer jersey. Clay Matthews, probably one of your favorites.
Of course.
Awesome. And I had to borrow that. There's no Green Bay Packers in my house at all. I had to borrow that shirt. My dad was a great Packer fan, though, so I kind of love him, too. Now, the Green Bay Packer fan was walking by, and of course, there's a deep-seated prejudice between Packer fans and Viking fans, but this Packer fan sees the Viking fan on the ground bleeding and, of course, hears her moaning and groaning louder. Okay. She's moaning and groaning, and what does the Packer fan do? Helps her, kneels down, binds up her wounds, bandages her, helps her get up onto her feet. Finally, Mary, right? Yes, thank you. Helps her get up onto her feet, puts her into his Green Bay Packer car, green and gold car, and they drive to kind of the healthcare managed system in St. Paul, where she is able to go, and she pulls out her Green Bay Packer Visa card. Do you have a Green Bay Packer Visa card?
No.
No. Tells the hospital that if there's any need whatsoever, to charge it to her Green Bay Packer Visa card. And then Jesus says, let's hear it for our actors one more time. And then Jesus says, go and do likewise. Go and he asks the question, who was it that acted as a neighbor to the one who was on the side of the road? And what would be the answer? The Green Bay Packer fan. And Jesus says, go and do likewise. Awesome. That's great. Round of applause. Okay? And you can keep the jerseys on if you want. You don't need to, but I do need them back for the 10:30 service, okay? Awesome. Thank you. It's a familiar story, the parable of the Good Samaritan. So familiar that we name nursing homes after the Good Samaritan, or we name hospitals after the Good Samaritan. But I want to tell you that the Good Samaritan is way more than just a name for a nursing home or the name of a hospital. And today, when we think about the Good Samaritan, I just want you to think about the character of the Good Samaritan in two ways this morning. First, think about the Good Samaritan as being Jesus. I don't know if you've ever thought of the Good Samaritan as being Jesus himself. But remember, when Jesus is telling this story, he has now turned his path and his direction to Jerusalem. And he's on his way to Jerusalem where he knows he's going to suffer and he's going to die for our sake. In other words, he knows he is going to bind up the wounds of humanity. Jesus is the one who meets you and me when we are in those ditches of life. When we are down kind of in the dumps and maybe feeling like life is half dead. That's Jesus. He meets us in our ditches. In my office here at church, right next to my computer on my desk, and there on my computer, I do a lot of prep work. I do a lot of writing and preparing for Bible studies and for sermons. And right next to it during these winter months, I have a sad light. Everybody know what a sad light is? Anybody else have a sad light? I turn on my sad light because during these long winter months when there's not a whole lot of sunshine, and the days are shorter. I know that the gray days and the less sunshine, the less light, affects my mood. It affects my disposition. I try not to be grouchy to people in the office and at staff. I try not to be grouchy to you. But I know that it helps me to have that light next to my computer when I'm doing some work. And every time I see that light, I think about Jesus being the light of the world. And when I think about Jesus being the light of the world, it makes me smile. It makes me happy knowing that Jesus is the one who meets us in times when maybe we're feeling down or maybe when we're feeling a little bit anxious. So I'm reminded of Jesus being the light of the world. I have an advantage maybe over some of you in that I work here at Gloria Day, and so I can kind of sneak from my office, and I do this pretty regularly through the week. I come into the sanctuary for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, sometimes even 15 minutes when nobody is here. I have a quiet place that's kind of built into where I work here at Gloria Day. So I come into the sanctuary on most days, and I sit somewhere. I sit in different places when it's quiet, and I spend some quiet time with Jesus, the light of the world. And I pray, and I think, and I look up at the windows, and I see the design of the windows. And so in my prayer time, sometimes I pray for my family and my kids and what's going on in their lives. Sometimes I spend prayer for you and for all of you, and sometimes I even bring in a directory and kind of go through the names and think about you and pray for you, but certainly pray for this congregation and for its continued well-being in the gospel, its continued focus on going deep in faith and wider in outreach. Sometimes I bring my challenges before God, asking for strength. Sometimes I pray for our country. Sometimes I pray for our world. Sometimes I bring my grief, whatever's going on, maybe the grief of missing my parents who are now both gone or other friends who have died. Sometimes I bring my failures, I bring my sins, my areas where I know I've missed the mark. You see, you and I need that time. We need to take that time to continue to be in the presence of the one who is the light of the world. We're in need of Jesus. Jesus meets us in all of our ditches. He's the one who forgives our sins. He forgives our mistakes. He listens to us when we need to talk. Jesus is there 24/7 for me. He's there 24/7 for you. So don't ever think that Jesus, the Good Samaritan, is too busy for you. He's not too busy for you. Jesus says to you and to me, "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." You have your stuff going on in your life. I have my stuff going on in my life. Each of us has a story with lots going on, but Jesus is the constant. He's the Good Samaritan who is always there for us, who never passes by on the other side of the road, but always stops and takes time to bind up our wounds and to meet us in our needs. So first and foremost, when you think of the Good Samaritan, think Jesus for you. And then secondly today, I want you to think, when you think of the Good Samaritan, I want you to think of maybe the Good Samaritan being Jesus' representatives or Jesus' ambassadors. In other words, think you and think me. Think of the church on earth today of which all of us are a part. Because when Jesus gets to the end of the story, the one who meets us in our ditches, the one who binds up our wounds, he also looks us in the eye and he says to us four words maybe to memorize, Luke 10 verse 37, he says, "Go and do likewise." Go and do likewise. Having been met by Jesus, having been lit up by the light of the world, we are called then to go as good Samaritans, empowered by him to light up people's lives. There are so many people in this life. Some of them are friends of yours. Some of them are family members. Some of them are others that are here at church members, part of your church family, who are feeling scared. They're feeling alone. Sometimes they're feeling vulnerable. They're feeling in need. And it's not just me who needs a sad light, metaphorically. We all do in one way or another, and Jesus calls us to be Christ for one another, without prejudice, without judgment. A Samaritan stopping to help a Jew in Jesus' day would have been unheard of because of the prejudice, because of the prejudgment that went on between those two peoples. It was deep-seated. And so that was kind of the scandal of that story, that a Samaritan actually stopped to help a Jew. A Packer fan stopping to help a Viking fan. Wow. You know, I never thought I'd say this in a sermon because I'm such a big Minnesota Viking fan, so it pains me just a little bit. But Jesus says, be like that Packer fan. You be like that Packer fan. You go and do likewise. Seriously, though, there is no room, and part of what this parable tells us is there is no room in the kingdom of God for prejudice. There's no room in the kingdom of God for prejudice. So you think about who it is maybe in your life that you have some prejudice against, whether it be skin color, race, gender, religion, income level. I kind of think and laugh a little bit because I think when we get to heaven, God is going to assign to us a roommate, maybe of someone that we might have been prejudiced against in this world. And he's going to say, guess what? You're going to get to know this person in a much deeper and better way and come to love them. There's no prejudice in the kingdom of God. The Samaritan did not prejudge. He just saw a fellow human being in need, and he helped. My older brother Mark served as a pastor for 10 years at a church called Holy Family Lutheran Church in Cabrini Green. Cabrini Green has now been replaced by other developments, but back in that day, it was a massive housing complex in downtown inner city Chicago. And it was world famous, Cabrini Green. Maybe you've heard of Cabrini Green. It was world famous for all the wrong reasons. It was renowned for its breeding of crime, for its breeding of drugs and gangs. There were killings literally almost every week in Cabrini Green. Whenever my brother would go out on the street, he would wear his collar. People knew him as the pastor of the church there, and he felt safe. But I remember on one of my trips to Cabrini Green, I visited my brother, but I was there at the church, and I was visiting with the director of the day school that was connected to that congregation. She said it was difficult for some of the kids in Cabrini to interact in any kind of healthy way. The teachers, for example, would sit down with their 9-year-old students or 10-year-old students, and they would start asking questions to the kids. Questions like, how was school today? Or what do you think about this? Or how do you feel about that? Do you like math? And most of the time, they would get no response at all. Do you like sports? What kind of sports? Do you like hip-hop music? And they'd get a shrug of the shoulders. That's all they'd get. And the school director explained to me that for many of these kids in the inner city, being asked a question or an opinion about anything or even about how they feel was a totally alien experience for them. Nobody had ever asked them an opinion about anything. In 10 years, nobody asked them about their feelings. So the tutoring and teaching that went on there, in addition to helping with reading and writing and arithmetic, tried to help the children to know that indeed they have names, that they are valued, and that they are loved members of the human family and of God's family. But it's not just in the inner cities of Chicago. It's all over the place. You maybe have that need of someone to just simply stop and listen to you, to talk to you. If you have that need, we have all kinds of groups. We have all kinds of things going on at Gloria Day. We have Stephen ministers. Don't hesitate to let us know if you are in need of someone to just really focus in and help you by doing some listening, to assuring you that you are God's child and part of God's family. So it's not just in the inner city of Chicago, it's all over the place. It's your friends, your acquaintances, your fellow church members, your family members. We all need that. We all need somebody to talk to, somebody to let us know that we are valued and loved and cared for. So we are both recipients of Jesus, the Good Samaritan, But we are also one of his caregivers. Pastor Dwight asked in a sermon a few months back, he said, would you believe in a God, or would you want to be in relationship with a God who didn't care for you? And the answer is, of course, no. We wouldn't want to be in a relationship with a God who did not care for us. But with a God who cares for us, with a God who truly loves us, with a God who goes so deep with us that he gives his son on the cross so that we would have life, that kind of God and that kind of relationship is life-giving and it is life-changing. So invest time in not only being recipients of the Good Samaritan for you, but think about how it is that you can be a caregiver, maybe just a listener, whatever it might be, to someone in your life who is in need of a Good Samaritan. Show people that God cares by you caring for others. So today, yeah, we're met by an old friend, the Good Samaritan, but it's more than just a hospital or a nursing home name. The Good Samaritan is Christ himself, who meets us in our ditches, but also who then calls us, empowers us, equips us to be good Samaritans for one another. Thanks be to God. Go and do likewise, Jesus says. Amen. Now may the peace of God, that peace which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.